It's the show that showed Gandalf the shortcut to Mordor, but he said he preferred the scenic route. It's time once again for World of Stew.
You want a podcast? Here's a podcast. You want a podcast? It's the World of Stew.
Hello and welcome back to World of Stew. We've got some big news to get through, but before we get to that, I of course am Stew, and on the other end of the Skype line that is the communication hub for World of Stew should be my co-host Dave.
And here I am.
Right, now Dave, before we get started, normally we bang straight into the movie news when we start the show.
Normally we do.
But we have some big news of our own this week, Dave.
We do, and it is very big news. I'm very excited.
This particular episode of World of Stew, whilst it is episode 20 in World of Stew continuity, it is also episode 1 of our new tenure on Movie Utopia.
It is. That's fantastic. That's fantastic news. I can't believe we're on there.
So, yeah, once again, we are now back on the radio, Dave. We are on Movie Utopia. If anyone who's listening to this who isn't listening to it on Movie Utopia, if you want to check it out, it is basically an online radio station which provides all the movie soundtrack songs that you would love to sit there and sing along to. If you want to find it, go to broadwayutopia.fm. You'll see a little link there, and click on that for Movie Utopia, and it will bring up a little player, and then you can listen away. This particular show will be on Movie Utopia at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time in America on Saturdays.
See, this is perfect for me as well, because you wouldn't believe the amount of movie music I actually have on my phone and on my various listening devices to listen to. I just love movie music. It just always reminds me of my favourite films.
Now, of course, to you and me, Dave, in English pounds and pence, so to speak, that's 2 o'clock in the morning.
2 o'clock in the morning. That's not so bad. I can stay up.
Sunday morning. But like I say, 9 p.m. Saturdays, Eastern Standard Time, World of Stew is now officially part of the Sobel Nation. So, with that aside, that is our big news. It is time for the World of Stew movie news.
This reaches the geek universe. It's the World of Stew news.
Right, now Dave, we have got absolutely shed loads of movie news to get through this week.
I didn't notice there was an excess of news on the internet this week.
First of all, we'll start on a down note, and that way we can go up more upbeat. We have to say rest in peace to Mr. Wes Craven.
You know what? I have to say rest in peace as well. He will be sadly missed, but in a way, I kind of think he'd actually prefer not to rest in peace. I kind of feel he'd actually kind of maybe want to come back one last time and just shock us and surprise us that one last time. So, you know what? If that's what it takes, he's, you know, absolute legend that he is.
So, he, Wes Craven, unfortunately passed away on Sunday, just gone, 30th of August. He, of course, is most famous, bringing us the horror icon Freddy Krueger, and rejuvenate in the horror genre with Scream. Now, we will do a retrospect on his career, but that will be next week. But I just wanted to say that I was surprised that he only actually had 29 directing credits to his name.
He's that old, 29?
Yep, most memorably, other than Freddy, and the Scream franchise would be probably Last House on the Left, The Hills Have Eyes, and Swamp Thing.
Yeah, that's not as many as you would think, would it? I think there are an awful lot of movies that said Wes Craven presents.
Yeah, but there's a lot of that nowadays. Let's not go there, because that's a bone of contention with me when it comes to movies.
But it is a little bit, isn't it? I don't think it takes away a lot of the quality of his movies, but there are a lot of those these days.
Like I said, we will have a proper look at Mr. Craven's career next week, but just for now, rest in peace. And unfortunately, while we're on a downer, we also have to say rest in peace to the French film director, Pascal Chamille.
Pascal Chamille, I'm not familiar with him.
He's just recently died of cancer at the age of 54. He was best known for the rom-com Heartbreaker, which featured Vanessa Paradis and Andrew Lincoln, who, of course, is from Walking Dead.
Of course, Andrew Lincoln, yeah.
So, rest in peace, Pascal.
Shame to see movie makers go so early.
Now, it's kind of a running theme on this show, Dave, that we have to start, and while we're on a downer, because, you know, we've been talking about people passing away, it's Ghostbusters news.
Is it Ghostbusters news? Is it time for a weekly slating of Ghostbusters?
It is. We're not going to go into too much depth about it because we bang on about this every single week, but Bill Murray has revealed his reasons for agreeing to appear in the new Ghostbusters film this week.
Was it a big paycheck?
It might have been, but apparently he has said he has a lot of respect for the actresses and for Paul Feig, who is, of course, is directing. He also claims he was torn for years, Dave. He was torn. It was like a decision that he couldn't take lightly. He was torn. But eventually he decided he couldn't say no.
Oh, I see. So he was torn for years and years about the decision on whether to do another Ghostbusters film. But Garfield, that wasn't too difficult, was it?
Well, Dave,
yeah.
Bill Murray says he couldn't say no. I have a clip here that gives him some advice. That was basically my feelings when I heard that Bill Murray was going to be in Ghostbusters.
I don't think you can say it better than that, really, can you?
No. It was a toss-up between that and a clip from Grange Hill, Just Say No.
That's what I was thinking when you said you had a little bit of advice. I was just thinking, Just Say No! It's been years since I heard that song.
We're showing our age now, so I think we should move on quickly. We have some more Man of Steel 2 news. I don't know if you remember last week, we discussed the fact that George Miller was rumoured to be on to direct Man of Steel 2.
Yes, Man of Steel stroke Man of Mad Max.
Yeah. Kind of. Well, it turns out that was incorrect.
Oh, was it really?
It was, yeah. Max Miller, that's your fault for saying Mad Max. Max Miller would be a whole other different kettle of fish. George Miller is going to direct a DC movie, but it appears it's going to be a different one, and it's not been announced yet which one he's going to work on, which means Man of Steel 2 is on permanent hold.
Ah, I see. Well, I will hold with bated breath because I know DC have quite a few characters who they want to make films for. I know there's Cyborg, Aquaman. I'm not really sure who wants to see an Aquaman movie, but there you go.
Ariel, she wants to see an Aquaman movie.
I'm sure she does. I'm sure she'd love to have a cameo somewhere.
Speaking of DC, though, Dave, and this is bad news, apparently they are hinting that they are talking about a further 3 Batfleck movies.
3 Batfleck movies?
Do you know what I say to that, Dave?
No! 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 No!
That's what I say to that, Dave.
You know what? I can't help but feel like we're judging Ben Affleck a little bit too harshly for this, but I'd be interested to know, is it that they're just playing 3 Batman solo films, or is it that they signed him up for Batman vs. Superman, and then a Justice League movie, and then to appear in another movie? Is it the same kind of deal that Marvel have done with, say, a Tony Stark character, to say, okay, look, you're going to be in 5 movies, and one or two of those will be Iron Man, and then another one will be a team-up movie?
Well, no, what
that does sound an awful lot of movies, doesn't it?
No, what I've read is it will be a trilogy of Batman solo films.
You know, I do love Batman, but I'm not sure we need another trilogy of Batman films so soon.
Funny you should mention Marvel there, by the way, because now we move on to the big news of the week. And I must point out to anyone who's listening to this right now, this is going to be full of spoilers.
Okay, that'll be interesting.
Right, and it's all about Captain America Civil War. Now, I don't know if you've seen this news this week.
I saw they released some news of who was going to be on whose side.
Yeah, there was basically nothing official has been announced, but Jeremy Renner has posted or tweeted, should I say, on Twitter about this, and he's tweeted or retweeted someone else's tweet of a couple of images relating to the film, some concept art, right? Now, this concept art shows that Team Iron Man comprises of The Vision, Black Panther, War Machine, and Black Widow.
Okay.
Whilst Team Cap is Agent 13. For those of you who don't know, that is Sharon Carter, who, depending on the continuity of the character, is either the daughter or the niece of Peggy Carter, who was, of course, Agent Carter in the Netflix TV series. Hawkeye, Bucky, Falcon, and Ant-Man.
Okay.
Right. And apparently Spider-Man is going to start on Iron Man's team and then flip-flop to the other team.
See, if you're a fan of Marvel there, though, if you've read the Civil War comics, that's, there's no big surprises there, if I'm being honest.
But do you know what this art kind of emphasises for me? And I know we've had this discussion before, and I am looking at it from a comic book point of view, but it just doesn't look right. If you compare the image to a similar image from the comic book storyline, Civil War, it just doesn't look like much of a war. Like, you've got, because in the a particular picture I saw on Google, you had obviously Spider-Man in the picture, She-Hulk, the Fantastic Four, Moon Knight, Luke Cage, Doc Samson, the Wasp, you know, Sentry. You had all these characters, so it looked like a war. With just four on each side, it just looks like a tag team match.
It does a little bit, doesn't it? But I wouldn't be surprised if there's going to be a few more characters which they chuck on in there. I wouldn't be surprised if we see Ant-Man in there. I wouldn't be surprised if we see Wasp in there at some point. And who knows, what I would love to see, which would do them huge favours for next year, is a little Doctor Strange cameo somewhere in as well.
And apparently, Spidey, who's going to be in the film, is going to be a teenager, as we know. And in another breaking of continuity, they're going to have it that he gets his web shooters made for him by Tony Stark.
Okay, that'd be a little bit different, won't it? If they're introducing a new Spider-Man character, I don't really have a problem with that, if I'm being honest. Because if they're making him such a young teenager, it would kind of make sense that he's not able to make that kind of complex technology himself.
But the whole point is, he's supposed to be super clever.
He is super clever, and he's a super clever scientist, but it's still quite a reach to have him make that kind of technology himself. Something that no one else has ever been able to copy at such a young age. But it does kind of also raise the question, if he swapped sides halfway through Civil War, and it was Tony that made him web shooters, what's he going to do when he runs out halfway through Civil War? He's just going to be the guy who calls up walls again.
Well, it would be similar to all the other films where he's run out. Because I lose track. Isn't it in the original Spider-Man trilogy that it just shoots out of his wrist? And then in the two Amazing Spider-Man films, he has web shooters again.
It is. The two Amazing Spider-Man, yeah, he creates web shooters, doesn't he? But for the Tobey Maguire films, he shoots it out of his wrist. Except halfway through Spider-Man 2, where he suddenly gets a crisis of conscience and doesn't seem to be able to do it anymore.
Shoots blanks.
Yeah, he's shooting blanks for half a movie.
Biggest spoiler of the lot, though, Dave, and I don't know if you want to hear this, but it relates to a death.
I think I probably know already anyway.
All right, okay. And apparently the first death has been revealed that it will be old lady Peggy Carter.
Oh, not Peggy Carter.
Well, she is ancient.
She is.
So it's not exactly like it's a big miss. Plus, of course, the fact that she dies as an old lady doesn't stop them making more Agent Carter from when she was a young gun.
It doesn't, does it? And she has done a great job being in the Marvel Universe.
Now, moving on. I was going to talk about Star Wars, but then I watched the Star Wars clip and nothing really happened.
It doesn't really happen, does it? Do you know what, though? It's only a very short clip, but something I've been very impressed with so far, for all the Star Wars stuff I've seen, is the amount of props, the amount of scenery that, I don't know how better to say this, but it's real stuff. You know, they're really making the stormtroopers, they're really making they're really making animatronic aliens and stuff. Obviously there's going to be a lot of CGI, but that's something I really enjoyed from the original Star Wars movies, as opposed to prequels. Was original movies, okay, a lot of it was kind of stop motion animation, but your eyes looked at it and you could see it was there, it was real, it had texture. And however great the special effects were for the prequel trilogies, it's just not the same.
I'm assuming you're not a fan of the rejigged originals.
I'm not. I know George Lucas has done a lot of fiddling with the original trilogy, and there's an awful lot of bits which just don't make sense and don't add to it in any way. I just hope now Disney have bought it from him, they're just going to tell him, look, stop messing with it. You've ruined it. There's so many little bits which he's spoiled.
Speaking of Disney, obviously they own the world.
But, they do own the world now, don't they? All apart from DC.
Yeah. Kevin Feige, is it?
I think it's Feige. I always wanted to say Kevin Feige, but it is Feige, apparently.
Well, Kevin Feige has managed to pull off a bit of a coup in that he has... Apparently he's always had run-ins with his boss at Marvel, so he has now negotiated a deal where he doesn't have to answer to that person anymore because he answers directly to Disney in exactly the same way that Pixar and Lucasfilm do.
You know what? I think that's quite a good thing, because Kevin Feige has obviously been doing a very good job for a long time. So, you know, if he's got creative control, then so be it.
What did you make?
I'm going to regret that in a few years, aren't I?
Yeah. What did you make of the Star Wars clip, though? Were you interested? Did it pique? Did it get you more excited?
It did. The more I see of the new movie, the more excited I'm getting, I have to say. Quite often, I've kind of said to myself, look, just don't get excited. We're not going to do this again. You know what happens. You just get let down. But actually, it's starting to look very good. And Andy Serkis' voice, I believe it was in the trailer. I believe it was Andy Serkis' voice. I may be mistaken, but Andy Serkis does have a huge role in the new movie, and he's always good. So, yeah, I'm excited.
And finally, in this week's huge bumper block of news that we've had, we have this, that apparently Nintendo have stated that they may once again delve into the world of movies based on their video game franchises. They have, of course, done this before with 1993 Super Mario Brothers, most famously, which was widely considered a terrible film. So I was thinking about this, and I know you're not a Nintendo boy, you're a Microsoft boy.
I am.
But what Nintendo games would you like to see on the big screen?
You know what? I think they could do a great job with Star Fox.
That is one of the ones I had listed.
Yeah, considering what they... You know, the movies that have been on the last couple of years, Guardians of the Galaxy, and, you know, all the Firefly series, I think Star Fox, I think, could be a great movie.
I've also got listed down Donkey Kong.
Donkey Kong, that could be interesting, put it that way.
And based on the fact that people love epic fantasy films at the moment, Zelda.
A Zelda movie could be sweet, I have to say, as long as we... I don't know if they'd have to do it seriously or make an animated movie. I don't know. But, yeah, I just consider... I have played some of the Zelda games, and they are epic. So I think if you put the same story into a film, that could be great.
And maybe going back to Mario one more time?
No.
No?
It's, you know, Mario's great. It's a great video game, but I don't think it belongs up on the silver screen at all. And I think that original movie shows why.
And that, in a nutshell, well, I say a nutshell, but it was more like a Donkey Kong monkey nutshell. Do you like what I did there?
A very big nutshell.
Yeah. That is this week's World of Stew News.
This reaches the geek universe. It's the world of Stew News.
Right, so the main topic of this week's show, Dave, is Back to the Future, right?
It is.
Which is, rather depressingly, celebrating its 30th anniversary this year.
I can't believe 30 years has come and gone so quickly.
I feel proper old.
I can't believe that would have made me 8 years old when it originally came out. I can't believe that.
Now, not only is it the 30th anniversary, but I actually went to the cinema to watch this yesterday.
Yesterday?
Yeah, at the Electric Cinema, which was quite an experience, because I don't know if you've ever been to an Electric Cinema.
I have not.
We pre-booked a sofa, a two-seater leather sofa at the back of the cinema, and you go in and you sit down. They show like modern blockbusters, but they also show old films. For instance, recently they showed The Matrix.
Oh, cool.
And they also recently showed The Lion King. So anyway, we booked a 2-seater leather sofa to go and watch the 30th anniversary of Back to the Future. Now, because you book a leather sofa, you get a menu with a text waiter service.
That sounds very nice. I like that.
And they don't sell popcorn and the like in an electric cinema. They actually provide fresh homemade cakes, slices of chorizo, a pit of bread with hummus to dip it in, bottles of wine, champagne, beer.
I'm gonna have to find out if there's one near me. This sounds good.
So anyway, I didn't actually want anything to eat, but I was sat there, so I had to use the text service just so I could say I'd done it. So I ordered, because I'm not drinking alcohol, I ordered myself a pineapple juice and some chorizo, which is very nice. But none of that's got anything to do with the film, and we're not going to talk about food. The reason why I have decided to do Back to the Future this week, we should just point out to anyone who's new to the show, we take a look at different movie franchises. So far we have gone through the Terminator franchise, we have gone through the Alien franchise, and we've gone through the Fantastic Four franchise. We run through the plots of the film, giving a sort of sideways look at our take on how good or bad they are.
Well, we've veered towards bad at some points, haven't we? But, you know, I think we do have a love of these movies as well.
Well, the thing is, right, the Alien franchise has stuff to like and loathe about it, right?
Right.
The Terminator franchise most certainly has stuff to like and loathe about it.
It does.
Particularly when you're talking about Terminator Genesis, which is god-awful.
It is awful, and I can see, you know, I've been thinking about that a while. I can see what they've tried to do with rebooting it in the same way they've done with some other movie franchises, but I do not approve.
And the Fantastic Four, obviously, that we did last week, that too, the most recent reboot, is just terrible.
It is. I have heard how terrible it is, and it beggars belief of how poor some people have told me that movie is.
But herein lies the problem. Back to the Future, despite, and we will get to each film individually in a minute, but Back to the Future is one of those beloved films that there isn't really that much bad going on.
I absolutely agree. I don't think there's a lot bad going on at all.
In any of the three films?
Well, even the third one, I don't think it's the strongest part of the three films, but it still works absolutely amazingly as a film.
So, with that in mind, Dave, shall we begin? Back to the Future is obviously about time travel. Now, time travel, as a concept for movies, is a difficult thing to pull off. Would you agree?
I would agree, though. I think a lot of people have tried it in the past, and they haven't always succeeded. I think sometimes people just think it's, yeah, great, you can go in, you can make a time travel movie, but there have been some pretty poor time travel movies.
Yeah, basically, there have been many attempts to make time travel movies, most of which have fallen flat on their face once the plot has become too convoluted and twisted into knots to make any real sense. It is very rare to find a time travel film that is so good that the viewer can ignore the gaping plot holes and just go along for the ride. It's even rarer that a film in this genre becomes a beloved classic, and yet in Back to the Future, I will argue, as we go through, that you don't just get one, but you get three. Yes, the third installment lacks some of the charm and character of its predecessors, but in my opinion, it's still a damn fine film and a worthy entry in the trilogy. With that said, let's begin at the beginning and take a look at 1985's Back to the Future. It was written and directed by Robert Zemeckis, who was coming off the success of Romancing the Stone, and who would go on to direct not only the Back to the Future trilogy, but also the likes of Who Framed Roger Rabbit, which I love.
You've got to love Roger Rabbit, really, haven't you?
Death Becomes Her, and he would also fall in love, apparently, with Tom Hanks, because they worked together on Forrest Gump, Castaway, and I think the third one was the Polar Express.
Polar Express, yeah, they did do Polar Express together as well, didn't they? Although that was just Tom Hanks' voice, was it not?
but it did look very much like Tom Hanks.
It did.
Back to Back to the Future. It, of course, stars Michael J. Fox and Marty McFly. He had already at this point had a 12-year career, although he hadn't found mainstream success except for a TV role as Alex in Family Ties. His buddy in this film would be Christopher Lloyd, playing Dr. Emmett Brown, whose first role was all the way back in 1975's One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. He, like Fox though, had his great success on TV in the show Taxi, where he played a character called John Ignatowski, who apparently was a reverend, which I didn't know.
See, I'm going to have to try and find some old classic Taxi shows, because knowing all these people that have come from it, I'm going to have to find it online somewhere just to check it out.
And of course, it also starred Taxi, this is Danny DeVito and Andy Kaufman.
Well, Andy Kaufman, of course, from a great film a couple of years back.
What film?
Well, not Andy Kaufman himself.
I was going to say, well, unless you believe the rumours that he's not actually dead.
Well, Andy Kaufman would, of course, love that you believe those rumours, but I was going to say Me, Myself and Irene. Obviously, that is not, definitely not the Andy Kaufman movie.
I think you're thinking of Man on the Moon.
I am thinking of Man on the Moon, a fantastic movie in its own right.
Particularly, surprisingly so, bearing in mind Jim Carrey stars.
Yeah, absolutely.
Steven Spielberg presents Back to the Future, a Robert Zemeckis film. Marty leads an ordinary life.
No McFly ever amounted to anything in the history of Hill Valley.
Well, history is going to change.
And 1985 is not his year. But Dr. Brown is about to change all that.
Are you telling me that you built a time machine? Out of a DeLorean?
He's sending Marty 30 years back in time.
It worked!
It's a flying saucer from outer space!
Now, he's trapped in the past.
This has got to be a dream.
About to meet...
Chocolate.
His future father.
He's a peeping Tom.
Wow!
And he's making an impression on his mother.
He's an absolute dream. And he can sleep in my room.
Anything you do could have serious repercussions on future events.
Now, he's got to make his mother and father fall in love.
For crying out loud, I haven't even been born yet.
And only Dr. Brown... can help him get back to the future.
Are you telling me that this sucker is nuclear?
Precisely.
Michael J. Fox.
Whoa, this is heavy.
Christopher Lloyd.
There's that word again, heavy. Why are things so heavy in the future? Is there a problem with the Earth's gravitational pull?
Back to the Future.
We begin in Back to the Future with Doc Brown's garage / laboratory. There's loads of stuff going on in there. Marty turns up and promptly plugs his guitar into a whopping great big speaker and blows the crap out of it.
See, that was just a great start to a movie, isn't it? Just having a character, okay, he's a character, he skateboards, he's got a guitar, and what else do you need to know about him? He's cool.
He gets a phone call from Doc Brown, who he goes, where have you been? And he's like, I've been busy doing sciencey stuff, and I want you to come and meet me at 1:15 a.m. in the morning at the Twin Pines Mall parking lot. Now, surely the first thing you would do is go, why do you want me to meet you at 1:15 in the morning?
Yeah, it would be a bit odd, wouldn't it?
But Marty never asked this question, not once.
I guess you just have to assume that Marty and Doc, they've had this kind of weird relationship for a little while, and that he knows that Doc is this kind of crazy, zany, mad scientist.
So anyway, the clocks all go off. Marty realises he's late for school, so off he goes. Bumps into his girlfriend Jennifer and tries to avoid the principal Strickland, who bumps into him, and they have a head-to-head where he tells Marty that no McFly has ever come to anything in the history of Hill Valley, which is obviously where they live. Then, in a little nod to what's coming, Dave, Marty says, history's gonna change.
Ah, I never spoiled that right from the start. History's going to change.
So, after school, Marty tries out in the Battle of the Bands, I think it is. And his band is called the Pinheads. And they start playing Huey Lewis and the News' Power of Love. One of the judges tells him to stop because he's too loud. And that judge is Dave.
And that judge, you know what? I have no recollection of this part of the movie. It's so long since I saw him. Who's the judge?
It is Huey Lewis himself.
Huey Lewis, of course it was. I heard he was in that movie, but I never spotted him.
In a little tiny cameo, being the judge telling Marty he's just too darn loud. Marty gets all maudlin and tells Jennifer that he's never going to amount to anything. She says, don't worry, we're going off to the woods on the weekend. Oh, I bet you are. And they have a little conversation where Marty says he can't tell his mum because he thinks she was born a nun. Which, again, is another little wink to what's coming later on in the film. After that, we get some relevant information about the clock tower having been struck in 1955 at 10:04, and it hasn't worked since. And Marty goes home to find that his parents' car has been trashed. Who's it been trashed by, Dave?
It's been trashed by Griff, has not? No, not Griff, Biff.
Biff Tannen. Biff Tannen is the bullyish boss of George McFly, who is Marty's dad, who has basically crashed their car while drink driving, but is blaming George by saying that the car had a blind spot. Marty isn't happy because he wants to use the car to take Jennifer up to the woods on the weekend, but his dad's like, well, what do you want me to do? I don't like confrontation. The premise being that his dad is a bit of a wuss. Marty goes off to find Doc at the mall in the middle of the night, and Doc unveils a DeLorean to him, which he has turned into a time machine. Of course, Marty doesn't believe any of this until Doc makes the car disappear with the dog inside it. And the dog is called?
Dog is called Einstein.
It is indeed. Marty's like, Jesus Christ, Doc, you disintegrated Einstein. He's like, no, I haven't. All I've done is sent him forward in time by 1 minute. And in a minute's time, he's going to catch up with us and reappear, which, of course, he does.
No, in a minute time, they're going to catch up with him, surely.
Well, yeah, true. Yeah, they're going to catch up with him. Well, depending on how you look at it, anyway, someone's going to catch up with someone. So the car reappears, Marty keeps on filming, and it's then revealed that the car has been powered by plutonium, which has been stolen by Doc from some Libyan terrorists. He apparently was paid by them to create a nuclear bomb, and he basically ripped them off by just putting some pointless parts inside a shell casing while he did one with the plutonium. This is all well and good until the Libyans turn up and shoot Doc dead. Marty is obviously all distraught, jumps in the DeLorean, tries to drive away, hits the magic number, which is what, Dave?
That is 19...
No!
No? No, 85 miles per hour.
No!
What?
Come on, Dave, don't let me down. Third time lucky.
The magic number?
Yes.
The magic number, but...
65. No! Don't go down!
What?
88 miles an hour!
Oh, 88 miles an hour, what am I thinking?
You have just lost all your credibility for being on this show.
I just was not thinking.
So, anyway, he hits the magical 88 miles an hour and disappears. We don't see what happens to the Libyans, but we'll find out later on. He then appears in a field, drives through a scarecrow, crashes into a barn. The local farmer, who is Old Man Peabody, he comes out with his family, opens up the barn, sees the crashed DeLorean, and Marty gets out in his radiation suit that he had on because they were dealing with plutonium back in 1985. They think that Marty and the DeLorean are a crashed spaceship and alien, so they shoot at him. This means that Marty has to drive away in the DeLorean. Unfortunately, it runs out of gas, and he then discovers that he is in the year...
1955.
I'm glad you didn't say 1988 then, because I would have had to somehow do a Skype slap. So he's in 1955, and he goes to the local diner where he tries to find out where Doc lives, because he figures Doc is the only person that can help him. Whilst he's in the diner, he runs headlong into his father, George McFly, who of course is played by Crispin Glover, who has lost the middle-aged man makeup that he was wearing earlier in the film when he was playing George McFly 30 years later. They have a brief interaction. Biff, a young Biff, turns up and basically forces George to do his homework for him. Marty is then, why are you being pushed around? George disappears, Marty follows him, and it turns out that George is a peeping Tom.
Yeah, it's a bit of a... I'm not sure they'd include that in the movie if it was in today, but that bit is a little bit odd, isn't it?
George then falls into the road. He's about to get run over by a car. Marty runs into the road, pushes him out of the way, and gets hit by the car himself. Turns out that the car is being driven by Lorraine's dad. Now, Lorraine is Marty McFly's mum in 1985, And what he has inadvertently done is that he has put himself in his father's place of the first time that his father gets to meet Lorraine. So what happens is rather than falling in love with George, Lorraine, also known as Marty McFly's mum, starts to fall in love with Marty. What does she think Marty is called?
She calls him Calvin Klein, doesn't she?
She does, because...
it's on his underwear.
You're getting your kudos back, Dave, with each little thing you get right. You know, the 88 miles an hour, that's kind of fading into the distance.
Well, I remember that bit, because even at that... when I, at a young age, I watched it, I wasn't quite sure why it said Calvin Klein on his underwear. You know, at that age, I understood, okay, you might have Superman, or Darth Vader, or Luke Skywalker on your pants, but who's Calvin Klein?
Now, speaking of the Calvin Klein pants, I'm going to mention something about those when we get to the end of this film.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. Right. It's nothing weird, trust me.
Okay.
So, Lorraine starts to fall in love with Marty, who will turn out to be her son, but obviously she doesn't know that. And how does Marty know that this is going to cause problems in the future?
He's been told about the day his mum met his dad.
Yeah, but what evidence does he have that things are going wrong?
He's got a photo, hasn't he, of himself?
A photo of himself and his two siblings, his sister and his brother. And his brother starts to fade away, because what's happening is that Lorraine and George never get together, which means Marty is never born. Neither is Dave, nor neither is Linda, his brother and sister. So the main crux of the film is then Marty has to try and get George and Lorraine back together to save his own life. Whilst doing this, Doc has to help him get back to the future. Speaking of Doc, Marty tracks him down. He convinces Doc that he is from the future, and he takes him to the DeLorean to show him the time machine. He then goes back to Doc's laboratory and uses the videotape that he took of the 1985 Doc and shows him exactly how the DeLorean is powered. Now, my question here, Dave, is how does a 1985 video camera plug into a 1955 television?
See, that would be a problem, wouldn't it? I quite often can't get my 2015 TV to plug into my 2014 laptop. So I don't know how you get a 1985 camcorder into a 1955 TV.
Anyway, turns out that to power the DeLorean, you need how much power, Dave?
That's a lot of gigawatts, isn't it? I can't remember the exact number.
1.21 gigawatts.
1.21 gigawatts.
Now, obviously, plutonium is not readily available. And the only way they could possibly get that much power to power the DeLorean and get it back to 1985 is through a lightning bolt.
Doesn't happen very often, does it?
It doesn't happen very often, and Doc is like, well, we don't know when lightning's going to strike, so it's impossible, you're stuck here. Marty goes, ha-ha, that's where you're wrong, for I have a flyer here that was given to me earlier in the film that shows that the clock tower in town is actually going to be struck by lightning on November the 12th, 1955, so a week from today. So all I need to do is hang around for a week, let you figure out how to harness the power, Bob's your uncle, job's done. Unfortunately,
you know what? I think there's something interesting here, which has always kind of made me wonder, is when Marty goes to see Doc, the 1955 Doc, hasn't Doc just woken up from having been passed out?
Oh, well, he's banged his head, hasn't he?
Yeah, he's banged his head, but he's just had a vision of the flux capacitor, has he not?
He has, yeah.
Which is an essential part of the time machine. So it always just struck me as a bit odd that why did he have that vision in 1955 at the same time that Marty was just arriving back from the future?
Yeah, but originally when he had that vision, Marty wasn't arriving from the future, was he?
Or was he?
Who knows? Let's not go.
Does this mean this always happened, or does it mean this is the first time this is happening?
Let's not go there, Dave, because, you know, paradoxes. We're trying to be positive about these films.
Yeah, that could mess up your head, but, you know, it is a cool moment.
Yeah. So, Marty does his best to try and get George and Lorraine back together, while, as I said, Doc tries to figure out how to send the car back to the future. Biff, in the meantime, has problems with Marty, which results in a sort of skateboard chase around the plaza in which Marty basically invents skateboarding.
That would be quite cool to take credit for, wouldn't it, though? Inventing skateboarding.
But does that not mean in the future, right, from that timeline, that Calvin Klein invented skateboarding?
It does, doesn't it?
Anyway, Biff ends up in manure and he's mad, so he's going to get back at Marty. George doesn't have any confidence and he can't approach Lorraine, so Marty then pretends to be Darth Vader from the planet Klingon. You have to watch it to understand. And he scares George into asking out Lorraine. Lorraine doesn't want a bar of it because she fancies Marty, so Marty concocts a plan. This plan is that he will take Lorraine to the dance, whilst George comes along and saves Lorraine from Marty's prying hand, which is all a little bit weird since this is mum. And that will then mean that Lorraine falls in love with George and everything's groovy. Of course, the best laid plans of mice and men, Dave.
Always go awry.
Exactly. So what happens is Biff shows up and his goons take Marty away and put him in the trunk of the band. Do you remember what the name of the band was?
I don't remember the name of the band.
It was Marvin Berry and the Starlighters.
Of course.
So Marty is trapped in the trunk. Biff is getting frisky with Lorraine. And then George turns up. He decides to stand up to Biff, but Biff looks like he's going to break George's arm until George finally mans up and knocks Biff on his backside.
Truly great moment of the film, I have to say.
Now, I have to admit that when I was watching this yesterday for the 30th anniversary screening, I actually marked out a bit for that.
You actually geeked out a little bit.
I did geek out a little bit, yeah, even 30 years later. So anyway, George is now with Lorraine in the dance, and Marty is released from the trunk. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like they're going to kiss, and Marty ends up on stage. It's really long and complicated, where he is playing with the band. The George and Lorraine then kiss, so everything's going to be fine, and Marty decides to play Johnny B. Good, which means he also invents rock and roll.
So, in just a small space of time, he's invented rock and roll, he's invented skateboarding, and he's given people in 1955 the idea of Darth Vader and the planet Klingon and Calvin Klein.
Yeah, so Calvin Klein is responsible for a lot by the time we get back to 1985. Everything's fine at the dance. He rushes off to see Doc and he wants to tell Doc that he's going to get killed in 1985. Doc's not having a bar of it, so Marty writes him a letter. Doc finds the letter, rips it up. Before he has a chance to throw it away, there's a problem with the cabling that they've got rigged up for the DeLorean to hit the wire across the street with the lightning, so he puts it in his pocket. Is the next issue I have, right? Marty drives up the street, turns around, gets ready to zoom back down the street at 88 miles an hour, hit the wire exactly the right time, and go back to 1985.
Okay.
He decides to go back earlier than when he arrived so that he can warn Doc and save him, right?
Right.
He chooses to only go back 10 minutes earlier.
Well, yeah, I can see maybe he'd go back the previous day. Who knows?
Even half an hour?
Yeah, even half an hour. Give yourself some time.
Because the problem is that he gets back to 1985, but the car conks out. So as he gets out of the car, the Libyans drive past, and he, of course, is too late. He watches Doc get gunned down. He also watches himself in the car disappearing off to 1955, as well as the Libyans crashing, although we never see what happens to them. They just kind of crash and, well, I guess we're supposed to assume they're dead or something.
I think so. I think you're supposed to assume they're dealt with and, you know, they're not going to come back.
No. He is devastated, of course, because his friend Doc is dead, except Doc sits up and shows that he was wearing a bulletproof vest. Marty is all like, well, what's all this nonsense you told me about the time-space continuum and messing with history? To which Doc was like, I figured, what the hell? And that's it. What the hell? You're like this scientist who makes this big song and dance about the time-space continuum, and then you're just like, yeah, well, am I bothered?
Well, you know what? It's still, actually, who's to say that isn't what happened in the first place? Who's to say that isn't what always happened, that he had a bulletproof vest on? So, who knows?
Doc decides to go 30 years into the future, while Marty goes home and discovers that everything has changed. His mum and dad are a lot healthier looking and a lot happier together, and Biff is the wuss who gets told what to do by George.
So he has changed everything for the better.
He has changed everything for the better. He also finds that he has the Toyota pickup truck that he longed for before he went to 1955, and all seems right in the garden of Marty. He's standing there with his girlfriend Jennifer when all of a sudden Doc turns up in the DeLorean. He gets out the car and Marty's like, what are you doing back? He's like, you have to come to 2015 with me. And he's like, why? And he's like, no, you're fine. It's your kids. Now, the thing is, Doc knows that Marty isn't fine, because he's been to 2015 and seen how sucky Marty's life is going to be. So why does he say he's fine?
Well, I think he's, knowing what we know about Back to the Future Part 2, he's just telling him here to try and, I guess he's just trying to tell him back to, you know, to make him think, oh yeah, everything's okay, it, but, you know, I think Doc is trying to be careful how much he changes.
So anyway, Marty, Doc and Jennifer get into the car, because Doc says Jennifer can come along because it's about her too. The car takes off because Doc has changed it to a flying car and zooms off towards the camera with the message to be continued.
Do you remember the future?
Where? Back to the future.
Are we back?
We're back.
What do you mean we're in the future?
October 21st, 2015.
Marty, we're going to be able to see our wedding.
Wow. The future. I got to check this out, Doc.
Look what happened to your son.
He's a complete wimp.
Don't talk to anyone.
You've been looking, Bob!
Hey, look!
Don't touch anything.
I need to borrow your hoverboard. Come on!
And try not to look at anything. I didn't invent the time machine to win at gambling.
I can't lose.
I invented the time machine to travel through time.
Hey, Doc, I'm all for that. What's wrong with making a few bucks on the side?
Now,
the time continuum has been disrupted, creating an alternate 1985.
There have been a few changes.
It's like we're in hell or something.
No, it's Hill Valley, although I can't imagine hell being much worse.
But they'll all be back.
Eat less, slackers!
Biff?
Hello? Hello, anybody home?
Well, it can't be you. You're so big.
Michael J. Fox. Christopher Lloyd. Michael J. Fox.
More like a couple of teenagers, you know?
And Michael J. Fox.
Mom, is that you?
Steven Spielberg presents a Robert Zemeckis film, Back to the Future.
Gotta get back in time.
Part 2. Coming November 22nd to theaters everywhere.
Which leads us nicely onto Back to the Future 2, which takes place exactly after the events of the first film and was released in 1989, so 4 years after the original.
That did actually feel like a very long 4 years back.
It did. So, they basically begin the film by showing us what happened at the end of the first one, with Doc saying it's your kids, them all getting in the car and flying off. Except this time we see that Biff sees the car flying off and he wonders what's going on with a flying DeLorean. Now, I would personally would be a bit more freaked out than he is, but what do I know?
Well, you would be a bit freaked out, wouldn't you? But at least, you know, I always thought the DeLorean itself looks like such an amazing car anyway, and something you'd never normally see.
But it's flying, Dave.
Yeah, it's flying, but, you know, to me, I remember being as a kid, the DeLorean itself looks amazing enough anyway. To see it fly, you'd just be like, oh my God, that's a flying DeLorean.
Yeah, but he's not like that, is he? He's just like, oh, it's a flying DeLorean.
Yeah, he is.
So they end up in 2015, where Doc then knocks out Jennifer because she's not important to his plan. So why did he take her along in the first place?
Well, he took her along, didn't he? Because she'd just seen the DeLorean and she'd just seen Doc jump out in that crazy kind of like, right, you got to come with me quickly.
Yeah, but what he could have done, bearing in mind he has a time machine, Dave, is he could have jumped out and gone, all right, Marty, how you doing? Look, I need to have a word with you. How's about you send Jennifer on her way? Wait till she's gone and then just take Marty.
He couldn't he? But I think that's for Doc, isn't it? He's excitable and, you know, you think about it long enough, you think, right, we've got to do something, we've got to go back now. So, why now? You've got a time machine. Let's just take our time. Let's make out a really careful plan. And, you know, there's no rush. We've got a time machine. But that's for Doc, isn't he? He's a bit crazy. He's a bit madcap.
So anyway, the problem is not with Marty in the future. It was with Marty Jr., who is Marty's son, and is also, of course, played by Michael J. Fox, who is going to get himself into some trouble that night when he does a robbery with Biff, who is actually Biff's son. We never actually meet Biff's mum, funnily enough. We never know who the mother is. But anyway, the 2015 young Biff tries to coerce the 2015 young Marty into doing this crime, and Doc brings 1985 Marty back to 2015 to pretend that he's the 2015 Marty and say no to going along to the crime. Following?
That does all make sense so far.
Right. So all of that happens, and then we get another chase scene, this time with a hoverboard, which is another invention that we don't have in 2015.
Well, the hoverboard does exist, actually. The hoverboard does exist. It's a very rare device, but I have been assured, and I have researched, you can actually get a hoverboard. Unfortunately, yeah. You need a very specialised set of equipment that is totally ridiculously expensive. So it only exists in a very small area for a few scientists.
All of which ends with Biff and his goons crashing into the front of the courthouse and being arrested. Now that is the only time you see young Biff in this film, because he's not really important. Doesn't matter, because we're still going to get old Biff and then really young Biff from 1955. But I'm jumping ahead. Marty then sees an antique shop and he picks up a book that is called what, Dave?
It's called Gray's Sports Almanac.
Yeah, and that gives you the results of all sporting events from 1950 to 2000. Marty obviously thinks, well, I'll take this book back and make an absolute mint. Which Doc is all like, no, you can't do that because you cannot use time travel to benefit financially, blah, blah, blah. So he chucks the book in a bin. Now, watching all of this from the shadows is who, Dave?
That is old Biff.
It is old man Biff, who is the elderly version of the 1985 Biff and is the grandfather, apparently, of the young Biff, which I guess kind of makes sense. Anyway, while all this is going on, Jennifer is picked up by the police, who scan her thumb, and that comes up as identifying her as the 2015 Jennifer, so they take her home. This means Doc and Marty have to follow the police and hopefully catch up with Jennifer before she meets her future self, because meeting your future self could cause a huge tear in the time-space continuum and destroy everything.
It's funny how that's a kind of continuous thing in lots of time travel movies, because they did that in that Jean-Claude Van Damme film as well, Time Cop.
Yeah, well, we all know what happens there.
Yeah, that's not good for whoever does it, is it?
No. Jennifer ends up in her house in 2015, and she's not impressed when she sees her wedding photos and when she sees her daughter, who is played by Michael J. Fox. George and Lorraine McFly turn up. Again, it's Leia Thompson playing Lorraine McFly, but it's not Crispin Glover playing George McFly. This time round, it's an actor called Jeffrey Wiseman. The reason for this, Dave, is that Crispin Glover was not a fan of the end of the original film, because he claimed that it gave the message that money makes everything right and will make you happy, which he didn't agree with.
Well, I'm not sure how he sees that. It's not just money, is it? It's standing up for yourself.
But the thing is, right, I was thinking about this, and this is why I wanted to go back to the Calvin Kleins. Calvin Kleins are not cheap.
They are not.
Right. And the car that is trashed at the beginning of the first film is a BMW.
Yes, it is.
Which, again, is not cheap. So, it's not like the McFlys were necessarily poor at the beginning of Back to the Future.
Yeah, I never thought about it that way.
I'm not saying they were rich, and they obviously weren't as wealthy as they were at the end of Back to the Future, but they weren't poor. So I don't think it's necessarily, like you said, the money that has made them happy. It's just the change in their circumstances and the lives that they're living.
Yeah, kind of a change in attitude of his dad.
So, Crispin Glover, I mean, I reckon it had something to do with the fact that he's hardly in this film anyway, that character, and he probably thought, well, I can't be arsed. But anyway, or arsed, just to give it the real British feel for any American listeners out there. Then Marty McFly, 2015 Marty McFly, turns up and he gets fired. Jennifer meets old Jennifer, faints, and Doc takes her away. They go back to 1985 and everything has changed, Dave.
It has changed, but they don't realise straight away, do they?
They don't realise straight away. They dump Jennifer on her front porch, and that's the last time you see her until the end of Back to the Future 3. Believe it or not, Marty's girlfriend does not appear again from that moment on.
So, the girls get a hard time in this movie, don't they?
They do. Marty then realises something's wrong when he goes home and ends up in bed with a young black girl, gets chased out of the house, realises that Hill Valley has become a war zone, and comes across the Biff Tannen Casino.
It wasn't just a war zone, was it? It was just a total mess. The whole neighbourhood changed to casinos and strip bars and pubs and bikers everywhere, just a whole mess.
Well, I say war zone because a tank rolls by.
Yeah, there is a tank in there, isn't there?
Yeah. So he goes in, finds his mum, who is now an alcoholic with huge breast implants. She is married to Biff because it turns out that his dad has been dead for 12 years. Long story short, he then goes to Doc. Doc goes, yes, it's true. What's happened is something's happened in the timeline and it's changed everything. Between the two of them, they figure out that young Biff has become a huge multimillionaire because he's bet on every single sport and event for the last 30 years and won every time. They look at a picture of him kept in his first check from a horse race, and they spot in his pocket the Grey Sports Almanac. Marty then goes back to the casino, speaks to Biff, who reveals that he got the book in 1955, which means Doc and Marty once again have to go to 1955 to get the book and stop all of this happening.
So I do love the scene here between Doc and Marty, where Doc is explaining with a diagram on a chalkboard just what has happened to the timelines. Because obviously Marty being Marty, Marty does have, I think sometimes we do dumb Marty down a bit to explain the time travel stuff from Doc. Because Doc explains, doesn't he, for a little diagram, no, we can't go back to 2015 to stop what happened, because then we're going to be travelling into this alternate future. The only thing we can do is go back.
Yeah, because they're now in what Doc calls 1985A.
Yeah.
So anyway, they go back to 1955, discover that old man Biff from 2015 has borrowed the DeLorean in 2015 and taken it back to 1955 and given young Biff the book. The old Biff has then gone back to 2015 and faded out of existence because he then doesn't exist because of the fact that the past has changed. We don't actually see this in the film, it's in a deleted scene, but anyway. Back to 1955, Marty has to go through adventures of trying to get the book whilst also trying to not interfere in the events that are happening from the first film.
Yeah, I do like the way they do this. I don't know if they shot everything again, or if they just, you know, I'd love to watch a proper making of Back to the Future just to see how they did it.
He eventually gets the book back and causes Biff to once again crash into manure. At the end of the film, him and Doc are going to go back to 1985, except the flying DeLorean is struck by lightning and disappears into nothingness. Marty is all like, no! Until a mysterious man from Western Union turns up with a letter for him. The letter is dated September 1885 and it's from Doc, who tells him that he is in the old Wild West and not to come back for him because he is living there happily. Marty is all like, there's only one person who can save me now. So he rushes back to Hill Valley, where the 1955 Doc is celebrating the fact that he's just sent the original Marty back to 1985 and says, Doc, I'm back from the future. You got to help me. To which the 1955 Doc just faints.
See, this was such a brilliant end to a movie. I have to say, every time I watch it, I just completely geek out, as we say.
From out of the west, in a cloud of dust, a thunder of hooves, and a mighty...
Great Scott!
I know, this is heavy.
Indians!
This summer, Marty and Doc go back one more time for their greatest adventure of all. Doc's living in the past.
Don't try it, Tannen!
But he's about to be history.
What kind of a future do you call that?
I'm going back to 1885 and I'm bringing you home.
It's the last roundup. It's the final showdown.
Hey, lighten up, jerk!
Where Marty makes a name for himself.
What's your name, dude?
Eastwood. Clint Eastwood.
What kind of stupid name is that?
Doc meets his mate.
You saved my life.
I'm a brown at your service.
And Tannen meets his match.
I'll hunt you and shoot you down like a duck.
It's dog, Buford. Shoot him down like a dog.
Michael J. Fox.
Where'd you learn to shoot like that?
7-Eleven.
Christopher Lloyd.
There's a fella that can't hold his liquor.
And Mary Steenburgen.
I never ever met a man like you before.
Gentlemen, excuse me, but my friend and I have to catch a train.
This summer, Steven Spielberg and Robert Zemeckis invite you...
Come on, Marty!
...to the Rough Rider. Rip-roaring, rootin' tootin', straight shooting.
Is this a holdup?
It's a science experiment!
Rousing conclusion of... Back to the Future.
Let the festivities begin!
Back to the Future, Part 3.
Now this, Dave, leads us on to the third and final film, obviously entitled Back to the Future 3, which takes place directly after the events of this film. Now, it was actually released only a year later, so I'm thinking they probably filmed back to back.
They did. You know what? I still remember going to see Back to the Future Part 2 at the cinema. I remember queuing up to see it. It was one of those cinemas where you actually have to queue up to get into the cinema instead of just buying your tickets and then just going to sit down. And right at the end of Back to the Future Part 2, just as the credits were about to roll up, they played a proper trailer for Part 3. So I'm pretty sure they did film them back to back.
Turns out in this letter from 1885 that Doc has hidden the DeLorean in a mine, and he's left instructions for the 1955 version of Doc to help Marty get back to 1985, because he doesn't want Marty to come back and save him. This would be fine, except for the fact that Marty and 1955 Doc discover that 1885 Doc is killed 1 week after writing his letter. He is shot in the back by a character called Buford Mad Dog Tannen, who of course is the descendant of the Biff characters that we've already seen in the films. Now, the thing for me with this is, I think this is probably the weakest of the Biff characters.
I think you're probably right. I think he is quite a kind of generic, bad cowboy, isn't he?
Yeah, he's played, of course, by the same actor, Thomas F. Wilson, who played Biff in all the films. But just for me, I didn't really connect with him in the same way that I did Biff.
I think... As an actor, I think you should recognise he does a great job playing all the characters, actually.
Marty decides he has to go back to 1885 to save Doc, which he promptly gets to do with the help of 1955 Doc. Back in 1885, he finds Doc. Doc's all like, what are you doing here? I told you not to bother. He's like, but you're going to die. Doc's like, okay, I'm coming with you then. The problem is that the car has no petrol, right? So whilst they can use rubbish to fuel the time circuits, the car needs petrol to run. Now, Dave, here is another paradox.
Okay.
There are now two DeLoreans in 1885.
You're right, I never thought about that.
Right. There is the DeLorean in the mine that Doc has put ready for Marty to find in 1955. There is also the DeLorean from 1955 that Marty has driven back to 1885.
One of the mine has to stay there so that Marty can have it to come back, right?
Yeah, absolutely. But, right, my point is, if Doc has only just recently put the 1885 DeLorean in the mine for them to find in 1955...
Right.
...there's nothing to say that there isn't petrol in it, right?
Right.
So there's nothing to stop them from taking the petrol out of that car, putting it in the 1955 DeLorean, which has gone back to 1885... so that they can get back to 1985, right?
Right.
And then when Marty finds the DeLorean in 1955, petrol is invented, so he can just fill that up then.
Yeah, you're right. But yeah, I guess we never thought about that, did we?
No, so there's a huge paradox there, but like I say, this isn't that kind of review. Buford turns up, and basically he is going to kill Doc over a horseshoe that he's put on his horse that he is saying came off while he was riding the horse. He was drinking beer at the time, which is a nice throwback to the first film where he crashes the McFly's car while drink driving. Before Marty meets Doc, we have what I feel is a really tacked on sort of sequence of events in the film where Marty meets his ancestors from 1885, and it just feels to me like they've just done that just to give Leah Thompson something to do.
Well, I always thought the weird thing here was the fact that Marty McFly, his ancestors both look like himself and his mum. So I'd be a bit worried if my granddad looked like, if my granddad looked like me and my grandmother looked like, say, my wife, if that makes sense. It would make me feel like something odd has gone on there.
But don't you feel like the whole McFly thing was really unnecessary in this film?
It was a bit unnecessary. I think it was just a, you know, they do it in all three of the movies, so they've done it in this one. I think that's what it comes down to.
Doc then falls in love with a woman called Clara, who he saves from falling down a ravine, which also changes history because her name was Clayton, and the ravine was going to be called the Clayton Ravine after she fell down it. But because he saved her, that doesn't happen, and the ravine actually ends up being named after Marty's character in 1885. And what does he call himself?
Clint Eastwood.
Clint Eastwood, so it becomes the Eastwood Ravine. Doc decides he's going to stay with Clara. Marty says you can't do that because you're messing with history. Doc says you're right, okay, I'll have to go. He goes to tell Clara he's leaving. She's like, well, why are you leaving me? What's going on there, you mofo? Obviously, she doesn't say mofo, but you know what I mean. He says, well, I'm a time traveler. She's like, well, if you're going to come up with a story, at least come up with something that's plausible, and kicks him out. Doc then ends up the end of the barrel of Buford's gun, and Buford shouts out to Marty, if you don't come out and give me a duel, I'm just going to shoot Doc dead. Well, all of this is going on, Clara decides to leave town on a train. Now, the train is important, and I should have mentioned it before, because Doc and Marty are going to hijack the train, or borrow it, as Doc says, to power the DeLorean, because it's the only way they can get the DeLorean to 88 miles an hour, by pushing it with the steam train.
Yeah, I always thought going fast forwarding to, you know, a bit of a giveaway to the end of the movie, if he was able to do so much with a train at the end of the movie, why couldn't he do that in the first place here?
Because it probably took him a long time.
I'm sure it did, but yeah, I guess they do have to get out of town pretty quick because there's a crazy cowboy on their trail. But, you know, I thought maybe he could do a bit more than he was saying. I don't know.
So anyway, Marty ends up in a duel with Buford. Buford shoots him. Marty's got a metal plate under his thing, which is a throwback to the Clint Eastwood film Fistful of Dollars. He has a fight with Buford, which knocks Buford into manure, to carry on that motif. After the battle, Buford is arrested, which changes the picture that he has of Doc's tombstone to blank, which means Doc's not going to die. Doc and Marty get the DeLorean, steal the train. They're pushing the DeLorean along to 88 miles an hour to leave. Clara somehow manages to catch up with the train, right? And Doc's like, all right, okay, I'm going to stay. And it's like, well, no, you can't because we're past the point of no return. So he decides, all right, Clara's coming with me then. He then uses the hoverboard from 2015, and Doc and Clara end up staying in 1885 while Marty returns to 1985. Luckily for him, it's the 1985 that he likes, where his family are happy and he has his Toyota Jeep thingy. And he goes and finds Jennifer, who is still asleep on the porch where they left her halfway through Back to the Future 2.
Yeah, see, this was always a bit of a point of contention as well. The fact that she slept through, even though she was put there to sleep in the parallel or alternative
1985A.
Yeah. 1985A, she stood asleep there in 1985B?
No, just 1985.
Yeah, just 1985. So, yeah, I'm not sure that would work out, but hey, it works.
The DeLorean is trashed by a train in 1985, and that looks like it's the end of it. Until they go to stand at the site of the trashed DeLorean to sort of reminisce, and a steam train turns up out of nowhere. On it is Doc with Clara and his children Jules and Vern. Apparently Doc has had time in 1885 to turn a steam train into a time machine. Not only that, but he has turned it into a fly-in train time machine, and he intends to travel through time doing whatever Doc does. That is the end of Back to the Future.
Now, what a trilogy.
Now, it is a good trilogy, but I do think the third part does let it down.
Yeah, I think the third part does let it down a bit, but I think you get that with a lot of trilogies. They come to this big problem at the end of the second film, which is then gradually resolved in the third film. It happens in trilogies, I think, and I still think the third film stands on its own, even though it's not quite the strongest part.
Now, looking at the actors from this film, now, unfortunately, 2 years after Back to the Future 3 was released, Michael J. Fox was diagnosed with Parkinson's, which he kept quiet until 1998, but which I think probably influenced the amount of work that he took on.
And, I think you're right.
And so reduced his potential for being a star, because he wasn't really in any more big blockbuster films. And the greatest amount of fame he found after that was in Spin City.
He was very good in that.
He was in 103 episodes of that before his condition meant he could no longer be in it, and he was replaced by Crazy Charlie Sheen, who I know is your favourite actor of all time.
Of course.
Christopher Lloyd, I would argue as well, as he's had a long career and he's got over 200 credits to his name, but I don't think he's done anything as memorable as Back to the Future since.
He hasn't. I just think the character of Doc Brown is just so perfect for him. The fact that Doc Brown character is just, you know, he's got the hair that makes him look like a crazy scientist, but Christopher Lloyd has just brought that character to life as well, just being so madcap, really.
Now, obviously, Robert Zemeckis made out like a bandit, because as we discussed, he went on to direct some big films after this. But in terms of the main actors who were in all three films, Leia Thompson didn't really do anything after Back to the Future.
Too true, yeah.
She's basically known as being Marty McFly's mum and having sex with a duck.
I'm not going to go there.
And Thomas Wilson, who played Biff in all three films, also didn't have much of a career, although he does have a lot of credits, and he was the voice of Catman in the Batman Brave and the Bold cartoon series.
Oh, was he really? I didn't know that.
He was. And Dave, he carved out a bit of a career for himself as a stand-up comedian.
Oh, really?
Yep. So what I've got here is I have got a song that he does on his stand-up. I don't know if he does it now, but he used to do it years back, called Biff's Questions.
Ooh, that could sound cool.
Right, so check this out.
In a plane or I'm on the street, there's a lot of friendly people that I like to meet. They shake my hand but never ask my name, and they start asking questions that are always the same. Hey, what's Michael J. Fox like? He's nice. What's Christopher Lloyd like? Kinda quiet. What's Crispin Glover like? Unusual. Stop asking me the question. I went to the bar mitzvah of my nephew Josh. Now I'm not Jewish, but I like to nosh. Put on my yarmulke, started to pray, when the rabbi leaned over and I heard him say, hey, was that real manure? No, it wasn't. How was that DeLorean? A piece of garbage. Do those hoverboards really fly? It's a movie. Stop asking me the question. Can we take your picture? Come on, look mean. Would you call my friend a butthead on his answering machine? Questions, questions fill my head. I went to my doctor. My doctor said, what does a key grip do? Set up lights. What does the best boy do? Help the key grip. What does a producer do? I don't know. Stop asking me the question. Do you all hang out together? No, we don't. How's Crispin Glover? I never talked to him. Back to the Future 4. Not happening. Stop asking me the question. Hey, who's the nicest famous guy you know? Adam Sandler. Who is the biggest jerk? Gary Busey. How much money do you make? More than you do. So stop asking me the question.
And there you go. So I found that on the internet, and I just thought that would be perfect to end the Back to the Future segment on.
Yeah, absolutely. I do feel for a guy like that.
So that was the Back to the Future trilogy, and there was only 3 films in that, right? But that took longer than any of the other franchises that we've done to date.
Did it really?
It did, yeah. In terms of notes and stuff, there are more pages on the 3 films of that because it is so complicated and convoluted that it just took me ages to try and figure it out. And then even when we just sort of zoomed through it in the way that we did, it's still taken longer than like last week's Fantastic Four, for instance.
And that's a simple time travel film.
Exactly. So we're coming to a close on this week's show. We were going to do a whole thing about Batman, which will happen next week now, because we are simply running out of time. But we cannot finish a show without something from you, Dave.
Okay.
Now, this will be new to Movie Utopia listeners. If they want to check out the first part of this, then they can find the World of Stew episodes that came prior to this one on the website, which is silentmovieman.wix.com/World of Stew. Now, the reason why they might want to go back and check out last week's Fantastic Four episode is that it had the first part of this. Which, of course, is your little thing that you came up with, where you've got 16 AIs, and we're going to determine which is the best.
It is. It's a tournament. It's a World Cup style tournament. So there will eventually be one winner. There will be a final. But, of course, last week we saw Ultron from the Avengers movies go up against David from AI, and Ultron was victorious. We also saw Agent Smith of Matrix battle HAL 9000 from 2001, which Agent Smith was victorious. But this week, we have a slight Terminator special.
Okay, so here we go with this week's Battle of the AIs.
This week, round one, we have the T-1000, which is of course the liquid metal Terminator from Terminator 2, versus Bishop. You don't know Bishop, he's Lance Henriksen as the robot from Aliens. But right, here we go. Bishop might be able to handle knife, but unfortunately this proves useless when the T-1000 comes at him, shifting his arms into a giant knife, impaling Bishop. The T-1000 stands victorious in a puddle of milky robot blood, now shaping himself into the form of an evil Lance Henriksen. Poor Bishop did not stand a chance.
Now, can I just ask, before we carry on?
Okay.
Is the T-1000 there, is that the Robert Patrick T-1000 or the new T-1000 from Terminator Genesis?
That would be the Robert Patrick T-1000. It would be the classic.
Okay.
I'm not sure what number designation they give the new one from Terminator Genesis. Just not anything to do with that one.
Just a T-1000.
It is.
Yeah. Anyway, battle number two.
Our number two is the T-800 versus Sonny. The T-800, of course, Arnold Schwarzenegger's Terminator. And Sonny is a nice, kind robot from the movie I, Robot. Anyway, Sonny's knowledge of Asimov's three laws and his protection of humans from other AIs has made him a target. So therefore, Sonny has been targeted for termination. However, initially taken unaware by the T-800's human appearance, Sonny is ambushed and critically damaged. However, Sonny is not as flimsy as he appears, and quickly sees something inhuman and monstrous standing before him. Sonny's speed and agility means he quickly turns the table on the T-800, disarming him and being able to bludgeon the Terminator. Sonny is literally dancing in robot kung fu circles around the Terminator until, damaged and reeling, the Terminator is crawling in the bloody mess. But alas, Sonny pauses. A moment's humanity, or mercy, is all it takes for the T-800 to grab Sonny, and, unable to escape his titanium alloy grip, Sonny is literally ripped apart, limb from limb, by the more relentless machine. So the T-800 wins.
Which means joining Ultron and Agent Smith in round number two are the two Terminators.
The two Terminators have both got through this week.
Of the 800 and the 1000 designations.
Would you like to know who we're going to have next week?
Yeah, who's up in round number one next week, Dave?
Round number next week is going to be Skynet versus Whopper. For any of our younger listeners, Whopper is, of course, a computer from a classic. Would you call it a sci-fi movie?
Well, I have no idea what film you're talking about.
Whopper is from War Games.
I guess so. If it's got AI in it, that's science-y enough for me.
Okay. But in round two next week, we have Optimus Prime, of course, the most famous Transformer, versus the Iron Giant from the film of the same name.
Can I just ask, is that Michael Bay's Optimus Prime?
Yeah, I'm afraid it's going to be Michael Bay's Optimus Prime.
Okay, fair. Is that the one that can fly?
Well, he might be able to fly, he might not. It depends if he's being powered up by someone.
You have to wait and find out next week, right here on the Battle of the AIs on World of Stew. Now, we have had so much to cram into this week's show, Dave, and there's so much that we didn't do, that next week's show's already half written.
It is. That makes it easy.
Which is awesome. Thank you to everyone for listening, and especially to anyone who is listening on Movie Utopia, our new home on the Broadway Utopia platform, part of the Sobel Nation. We are going to normally we finish the show with a sort of tongue-in-cheek song referring to the main topic of the show, but I don't think we can finish with any song other than The Power of Love, Huey Lewis, this week, Dave.
It's got to be Huey Lewis.
So we are going to close this week's show with The Power of Love by Huey Lewis and the News. Thank you once again, Dave, for being my co-host.
Always welcome, always fun.
That's like your new catchphrase now, isn't it?
I guess so.
Are you going to get a T-shirt with that on?
I might have to.
You're going to have to, or a wristband.
I'm not sure what people think of it.
Before Christmas, I want to see you in a wristband saying, always welcome, always fun.
Okay, you got it.
In fact, I might even buy it for you.
Well, if you want to buy one for me, then go right ahead.
Until next week, everybody, keep it geek.
Love.